Hi, my name is David Craker. I work at the United States Census Bureau as a data dissemination specialist. For many years, I worked as a geographer. And today, what I'm going to do is walk you through this presentation, explaining to you statistical geographies that we use at the Census Bureau and which might help you find your data. A couple of things. While we go through this presentation, one, I will take you on a little bit of a field trip at one point. And another point, I want you to look for what I call a lanyap. A lanyap is sort of like a little bonus, a little present that we give you for you to get something extra out of this. So look for that lanyap as you're going through this. It'll help spark your interest. So this module covers statistical geographies. It's part of a larger presentation called the ins and outs and whereabouts of census geography. But let's look to the right here and think about what we will look through today. We will look at census block, the block group, tract, designated place, census designated places. Sometimes I like to put a hyphen in there. Census county divisions, metropolitan and micropolitan statistical areas. We call those MSAs. Public use microdata areas, those are also called PUMAs, and zip code tabulation areas, and we do call those ZIGTAs.
What is statistical geography? It's an area of interest used for understanding statistics and numbers that is created when administrative or legal geographies are unavailable or insufficient.
Let's move on here. This is what we call our hierarchy at the Census Bureau, and we actually are going to look at the ones that I've bolded here in this blue, dark blue color. We're moving up the ladder today, or up the hierarchy. So we start at the bottom with block, then block nests within block groups, and tract nests within that. And then notice things, for example, at the upper left, ZIGTAs actually nest within the nation. So just keep that in mind. I know that's kind of a hard thing, but we do have this little hierarchy. So let's think about the census block. We look over here on the right. We have an area. This is block 1000. There's a river on the left. There's a railroad on the right. It is the smallest geographic area that we present data for. Usually that's for decennial. For other things, we're going up higher on the food chain. These are the building blocks for everything. They are bounded by visible features or survey features, and they often correspond to city blocks. And so that is something to keep in mind as we move along here.
Hi, we're out here today. We're going to be walking around this block. As you can see behind me, there's a huge car park, but we're actually going to go up that street and walk around this block really quickly. And I want you to remember a couple things about census blocks. They are self-contained, so we'd like to begin at one spot, walk around the block or drive around the block, and end up where we started. They're usually things we can see on the ground, or they could be survey boundaries. And then the other thing is that we are actually, census block is actually something we created to capture the potential, the population potential. So that means that perhaps nobody is actually living here right now or hasn't built a house, but they may someday. And so that is part of the reasoning behind these sort of self-contained blocks to hold population. All right, let's take a walk.
Okay, here we are at the corner. We're going to start walking up this street really quickly, and then we're going to turn the corner. Oh, those are nice homes. Keep going. Turn the corner again. Oh man, look at that tree. Down the street and around the corner, lots of homes, but over here there are a few apartments. We keep going, and then we get to our car park again and back to square one. That was a block. So let's look at this, a block group. A block group is actually a subdivision of a census tract. It's a way to present data and control block numbering. We do have a sort of a range for block codes. There's some limited data available at the block group level, and it's the smallest unit for sample data, meaning data coming from ACS. but it is one thing we have participants participating with us every 10 years, renumbering their block groups if they see fit. We also have this thing called the Census Tract, and this is really the showcase geography that the Census Bureau has developed that back in, released it nationwide back in 1940. It's very permanent, meant to be used temporally. It's created for presenting statistical data. The boundaries are often visible features that you can see on the ground, but they could be survey boundaries as well.
Around the country, there are about 4,000 people in a census tract. And so this is a very good way to analyze demographic data if you need to look at that.
But we also have to think about this. Since I said we have 4,000 people in a census tract, what happens if the census tract swells up in population? And so at that point, we're going to have to divide a census tract, right? And we would take tract number 125, and then that would become 125.01 and 125.02. If you were looking at this not on a map, but on a list or a chart, you probably are going to have to go looking for a geography crosswalk, which we do supply, and you can figure out what things have changed going back through time. So something just keep in mind as you're looking and working your census tract. To have this thing called a census county division, and that was on that hierarchy, right? And this is a part of a county. This map is not the easiest thing to read over here on the right, but it is a subdivision of a county where we do not have minor civil divisions. So where we don't have townships or towns, we have created in those states census county divisions. They are not widely understood in many of those counties, but it is a way for you to analyze your county with a wall-to-wall coverage of geography, so that you know you can see data for the whole county, wall-to-wall. So one thing just keep in mind when you're looking for this sort of information. We also have this idea of the census-designated place. Like I say, I sometimes like to put a hyphen in there, but here's a map. It's Syngac, New Jersey. It's the statistical counterpart of an incorporated place. It is not incorporated, but it's a place that looks like probably it should be incorporated. It is a settlement or a concentration of population, and we delineated, Census Bureau delineates it with the county. Usually every 10 years we offer that to the county. There are some places where there are no incorporated places, Hawaii, Puerto Rico, and Guam, and they only use census designated places to get data. The next thing we have is the metropolitan micropolitan statistical areas. We just call those MSAs for that represents both of these types of areas. So the idea is to have a core area with a large population in it. Usually that population has to be over 50,000 people. So here we have on the right, Kansas City. Kansas City certainly has over 50,000 people, but then around that we have some micropolitan statistical areas, and those areas generally have 10,000 to 15,000 people in them, and they are sort of outlined or surrounding the main area. So that's something to keep in mind. It is dependent on decennial population.
The Office of Management and Budget, not the Census Bureau, delineates these areas after 10-year census depending on population increases and where they see fit.
We also have this thing called the public use microdata area, and it is a good thing to use if you use working with ACS data. We work with the state data centers to delineate these, and there's a threshold of about 100,000 people. So notice we use the word micro or microdata area up here. And what that means is you can get more data. You're getting smaller and more precise data if you need that, but the area gets larger in population. So over here on the right, this is a good little diagram here. It comes from the city of New York. They have what they call CDs, community districts. So community district 4, community district 5. You can see this back here. and that corresponds to Puma number 3807. One thing I will point out, Pumas used to be numbered, and now they are named, and that is to help reflect the area that they are within. So here we have urban areas, and that's really sort of a collective terminology. It refers to both urban areas and urban clusters. But let's just think about this, and I'm sorry I don't have a better diagram, but urban areas are actually just densely developed territory, has to have at least 50,000 people in it. And usually it's in the vicinity of a larger populated place. Then we have urban clusters, and urban clusters are somewhere, has to have at least 2,500 people in it, but all the way up to 50,000. And they're sort of surrounding these other urban areas, if you will.
Going forward from 2020 census, urban areas will no longer be distinguished as either an urbanized area or an urban cluster. All qualifying areas will be designated urban areas. So look for that change.
Let's move on to zip code tabulation areas, right? And so zip code tabulation areas approximate a five-digit zip code area, but we actually create these using populations that are primarily in certain zip codes. But one thing is, a lot of people go looking for geographic files, right? And the zip code tabulation areas are actually free. And many other places where you look for that, you actually have to pay for that data. So here's where I'm going to give you a little lanyap. And if you want to go to this URL, you can actually see yours truly giving a little presentation on zip codes or zip code tabulation areas. And you can get a little bit more information on that. Why don't we move along? We sort of gone through all those different things, and let's just have a little quiz here. So if we think about this, which of these geographies average about 4,000 people and do not cross county lines? Okay. So that is the census tract. If you remember earlier, I said census tracts are sort of stable in time. They were created to have about 4,000 people in them, and as we move through time, we like to keep those census tracts in the same place. But remember, I said if one swells up in population, we will subdivide it and we will change the numbering scheme. So something to keep in mind as you go through this. Okay, our second little quiz here: which of these geographies can cross county lines? And there may be more than one answer. So the things that can cross county line, right, are actually metropolitan statistical areas, zip code tabulation areas, and urban areas. And so the one thing that got left out there was the block group. Okay, block groups nest, remember, within tracts, tracts nest within the county.